eternal, yet ever new. His advent and His proximity, His mystical leelas and His songs. Every mischief and miracle, a message memorable. Every pain and travail, a precept enacted. As the bud blossomed to reveal a thousand petals, it can only be said that the fragrance of the first few years was unique.
Before we begin, we pray to Swami that He gives us all the understanding, that He is the one who speaks and He alone is the one who listens. It is indeed a great opportunity for us. Swami would say,
Anand Balude, Anand Balude, Tanagumputo Aadu konagavache.
It is that very same Lord who came as the son of Nanda, who has come to recognize those that belong to Him.
Aramachandrude, Aramachandrude. Tanavantulanu kanugonagavacche.
That very same Lord who came as Ramachandra has come as Aramachandra because He has enough time. As we go through His stories, we will see that how leisurely He spent time with His devotees. And that very same Lord whom we worship as Lord Shiva, He has come to play with those who He recognizes as His playmates. And that Mahavishnu has come as this Vishnu who belongs to this very earth to gather what He considers as His weapons.
Swami is that supreme, infinite, and yet He's like a child, a playmate. This very photograph, for example, we can see Swami in all His splendor, divine majesty, with a garland, with a halo around His head. But do you know, this photograph was taken actually in 1944 in a studio in Bangalore, and Swami was forced to pose for this photograph. Swami never liked. In fact, one of the earliest photographs taken of Swami is when He's sitting and there's a rock in front of Him and the photographer says, Swami, can you move that rock away because it's blocking you? He says, no, take the picture nevertheless. And we know how that rock became an idol of Shirdi Sai Baba. And this was 1944, much after Swami had declared His avatarhood. And they said, Swami, we need to take a photograph of you as the avatar. So that's a halo drawn in the background. And the tiger skin has been placed, and Swami allowed, you know. Swami allowed Himself to be forced by His devotees for their joy. He put on whatever pose was necessary. He stood in the exact orientation so that the halo comes around the head like that. He must have been thinking, you just wait. In 10 years time, I'll have my natural halo which you can see. And we know that beautiful halo that Bhagwan had throughout His life. It is indeed a beautiful moment that we have all congregated to enjoy in the divine nectarine story of our beloved Bhagwan.
Before we begin the story of Swami, we would like to ask a few vital questions, because the answers that we, out of our understanding, give for these questions will make us understand what was Swami's perspective when he had a few choices to make.
The setting is this. Imagine God, our Swami, calls you. You are in the cosmos. He points out to the planet Earth and he says, "Dear child, the Earth is in a very bad situation today." We agree, right? The Earth is in a bad situation. So God says, "I want you to go and transform the earth, change the earth. And in order to help you in this, whatever you need, I will give. So you ask, I will give. I will equip you with all those. In return, I want you to go and make the earth a beautiful place to live in."
So what are the choices which will be placed before you? The Lord asks, "All right, you can choose which time do you want to go and incarnate to take upon this task of transforming the earth. It's very simple. You want to bring in transformation. The tool which we would use is spirituality. So spirituality should be palatable. The time should be such that people are in a mood to accept spirituality. A simple thing, we are sitting here and talking to this audience here. Will it be possible for us to speak if there is no silence in this hall? So to be heard, you need silence and peace." And Vivekananda would say that don't teach spirituality to a hungry man. Because even to indulge in intellectual understanding or any such exercise, you need your stomach to be full. You need your basic needs to be fulfilled. So wouldn't you choose a time when people are well fed, are well taken care of, are in a very secure situation, and are ready to listen to your spiritual message?
The next question. Now when you're going on earth, how much resources do you need? How much money do you want? You know, some group, they start saying about $1 trillion, about $1 trillion. You have to remind them that you have chosen to go 1500 years ago. There's no dollars at that time.
Even if it was there, maybe it was not as valuable as it is now.
And so, gold coins, yes. Because you know, it helps. Whatever you want to do, build hospitals or build good things, do any activity, it is good to have a lot of resources. And therefore, about 2 palaces filled with gold coins is what we will ask from God to transform the earth.
And now you will have to be born in a family, you will have to be born in a household, and you have to grow up like anybody else. So if you have to have an added advantage when you speak, if people have to listen to you, wouldn't you have to be born in a family of influence? Wouldn't it be nice if you were born to a powerful king, or if it was in the later year, to a politically powerful family? Wouldn't it be useful if you're born in a household where automatically you are an heir to a certain amount of influence?
The next question, you know, for this the answer was very unanimous. The next question is, where would you like to be born on earth? And they said India. Why? No, we are trained. In the Sai circles, we are trained. If you have to take birth in India. It's like, I remember in a Sunday school where you're taught the Bible. So a teacher is asking the children, "Guess who I am?" The first clue is, "I am tiny, I have black stripes on my back, and I run on trees." "Don't know." "I have a bushy tail, I eat nuts. I have 2 long teeth. And I am tiny." And none of the children are guessing, and the teacher says, "Come on, this is a very easy question. Don't you know the answer?" And one little child gets up and says, "Miss, I know that the answer is Jesus Christ, but that somehow sounds like a squirrel." We are so trained in some things that we don't even think what it is, but we know the answer has to be this. And so therefore, when we ask, where would you like to be born? In India. So that was unanimous. But then, you know, in India where? Would it not be nice to be in a place which is well connected, has good administration, to make your mission of transforming the world better? That they all agreed. So they want to be born in a powerful family with lots of gold, 1500 years back in India, in a town or a city that is very well connected with great administration.
No, the choices which were made were most common when we tried it out with different groups. These were the ones which they came up with. And I think all of us logically approve of it. We all kind of accept it. Now, this is if God vests certain powers and the ability to choose on an individual. What happens when God himself chooses? Swami says, you know, beautiful Padyam where he describes the advent. He says, Yuga dharma paddatul vigalitamayunda nayamarga munadrippi nadupu koraku. The world is full of chaos and everybody is going the wrong way. To correct them and to bring them on track, God comes. Lokambu lella kallolamai chediyunda nishkalmashamu chesi nilupu koraku. To clear this world of all the impurities, God comes. Durmarga vartanul trulluchu nunda sadhu samrakshana solapu koraku. Where everybody so easily goes into paths which are impure, which are wrong, God comes to establish goodness. So that Lord who comes, you know, these are the tasks he has laid for himself. What are the choices that he made? What were the places that he chose? What was the time? We spoke of what time would you choose. What was the time the Lord chose? He was born in the year 1926. That's not unknown to us. But when was 1926? It was bang in the middle of two world wars. The First World War and the Second World War. And how was it? People had most insecure lives. There was no access to basic necessities, even in some of the biggest cities in the world. And that was the most chaotic of times.
Can you imagine that? A collective group of youth have chosen a very peaceful time, that is the best time to be born in order to transform the earth. And here is God. Why is he making such a apparently unintelligent choice? He is choosing a time between two world wars. Swami Vivekananda said, don't teach spirituality to a hungry man. What about an angry man? When two people are fighting, you go and tell, listen, everything is Atma. They will chuck you and kill you there. In such a situation, the Lord decided to incarnate. And then, how much resources did he bring? When Swami's button from the shirt fell, he went to a nearby cactus plant, broke the thorn and pinned his shirt. He had only one pair of clothes. And what would he do after he returns from school because the clothes are soiled? He drapes the towel around himself, takes out his shirt and shorts, washes them, waits for them to dry. Can you believe it? The avatar, the Supreme Lord, waiting for clothes to dry because he has no other clothes to put on. And then he would take a metal pot, put embers in it and iron the clothes and then wear them on. He could barely eat two square meals a day. That was the kind of resources he chose. You can see it in the pictures. You see that black hole over there? That black hole over there is actually the shop that Swami's father owned. The shop which would sell little matchboxes, little things for daily use. This was how Puttaparthi was. You can see the residents, they're washing their vessels in a puddle on the road. When it would rain like this, it was a time to wash vessels outside. And this photograph, for your information, has been taken in the 1960s. You can only imagine the 1920s. This was the central temple, the Satyamma Gudi that you see today. This was how it was. So it was in this kind of absolute lack of resources that the Lord chose to make his advent.
And what about the choice of a family? You have to choose an influential family. You can understand how insignificant the village itself was. The pictures show that. In that village, in that insignificant village in the district of Anantapur, in a family which was not significant even in the village, the family which Swami was born into is called the Bhattarajus. They are the ones who are known for teaching the people the stories of the Ramayana, Mahabharata. The grandfather, Kundamaraju, he was the one who would play the role of Lakshmana in most of the plays. He was, of course, a very saintly person. People respected him for his saintly nature. This is Swami's father, Pedda Venkamaraju. And this is the mother. I mean, the pictures speak for themselves, don't they? How simple were they? And this was the father's house in Puttaparthi. And this was the house of the mother in Karnataka Nagepalli, which is just across the Chitravati River. There was nothing important about the family. And if the family spoke up, or if anybody from that family spoke up, not even the people of the village might listen. And he chose to be born in such a family.
Finally, which place? Yes, the avatar also chose India. But which place in India? Puttaparthi was described as being a stone's throw from Stone Age in the 1960s. You know, in India, there are two kinds of maps that are prepared. One is a geographical map, which points out important cities, towns and villages. The other is a postal map. Now you see, the geographical map does not have every village on it, because every village is not important. But the postal map has to include each and every village, because people live in each and every village and they would like to write letters to each other. And therefore, every village is mapped onto the postal map of India. Puttaparthi was not on the postal map of India also. The post would arrive to neighboring Bukkapatnam, from where once in a fortnight or once in a month, it would be bundled in a sack and got here. That was the kind of place Puttaparthi was. For example, you know, if you see these pictures, now we are fast forwarding 3 to 4 decades. How it was to come to Puttaparthi in the 70s, in the 60s and 70s. You know, now we just come land in the Bangalore airport, take a taxi, within 2 hours we are in Puttaparthi. Those days it would take 9.5 hours minimum to come from Bangalore to Puttaparthi. Just for your information, in 9.5 hours you can reach Amsterdam from Bangalore today. This is the Penukonda railway station where you'll arrive from Bangalore. You get off at Penukonda railway station, and this is a kind of cart that is waiting to take you from the Penukonda railway station to the Penukonda bus stand. Now this is the advanced Penukonda bus stand, 30 years after the time when this happened. From here you take a bus. It is a coal bus because it runs on steam. So if you sit in the front, you're going to get black. If you sit in the back, you're going to break your backbone. One of the choices you can choose, either you want to feel fit or you want to look fit. And then from there, you arrive at Bukkapatnam, and from Bukkapatnam, you climb onto a, if the horse cart was not enough, you climb onto a bullock cart. And this is supposed to be the road. I hope you can see the road. This is a road from Bukkapatnam to Karnataka Nagepalli. Hey, this is a 9-hour journey. What about rest in between? You know, if you want to have something to eat, take some rest, go to the washroom, there are some inns, little places to stop. One such is on the next photo, that tree. That's all it was. There was no rest houses, no hotels, nothing on the way. Trees. They would rest under these trees, devotees. And then finally, this is the path. You have to go across the Chitravati and then reach Puttaparthi. Such was the remoteness of Puttaparthi, and the Lord chose Puttaparthi to take birth.
Now, with our limited understanding, with our limited knowledge and reasoning, we came up with such brilliant choices. Now, it is said that the Lord is the one who is the very embodiment of wisdom, and He has made such choices. What do we say about that then? But when the Lord chose to come down, when He is in the midst of us, He says, I am not going to come with wealth. I am not going to come down with influence. I am not going to come down with a high pedigree, like what we thought it is very important. He says, I am going to come down with things which are most essential, which all of us have forgotten. He says, I will come down with nothing. I will seek nothing from anybody. I will not ask anything from anybody, but I will achieve everything. The fact that He has achieved everything, all of us are here to see. Because every day we sit, we look up, there is gold. We look up and look around, there is crystal chandeliers all around. This was the Puttaparthi we saw. this was the Puttaparthi we are all living in. We all know what a difference it has made, but the fact is we all have to remind ourselves that the Lord came with nothing. The Lord came with no influence, with no money, with no power, but He achieved all this.
He came with nothing, He asked for nothing, and yet He achieved everything. And on the face of it, when this is told, come on, He's God. After all, He's God. Why does He need to come down with anything? You know, we have different rules. The Lord will take care of the universe, but when it comes to my life, I need to take care. Swami, please let my daughter pass this examination. Swami, please let me get this job. The Lord says, my child, I know in my wisdom, I will take care. No, Lord, see, you take care of the world, I know. But my daughter's exam, I know better. It is good that she gets a top rank. We feel that the Lord's wisdom works for the entire world, but my life, you know, Lord, I know better. You please listen to me. So, we have different standards for ourselves and for God. And when we say that the Lord came with nothing, we don't get anything like a surprise, because of course He's God. Why does He need to get anything? He can do whatever He wants. And the Lord has indeed done some stupendous things right from His early childhood days.
Maybe at this point we could narrate some of the many things which Swami has done, which only proves this point you have said. You know, after all, He is God. After all, He can do whatever He wants. Many years ago, after Swami had declared Himself as the avatar, come for our redemption, He would take groups of devotees to Chitravati. That was the thing, a story we've always heard. So Swami would take one particular path and take the devotees to Chitravati. And en route in that path, there was an old lady who was staying all alone in a small hut. So every time, every evening when Swami would come that way, this old lady would come out of her hut and she would pray to Swami for permission to do Padapuja for Swami. She would offer tulsi leaves at Swami's feet and she would worship Swami's feet and go back into the hut. She would never follow Swami to the Chitravati. So this was a practice. Swami blessed her with this opportunity. One particular day, Swami looked at her and said, why don't you come along? Why don't you join us for our Chitravati session? So she was overjoyed at this invitation, so she came along. So Swami sat there in the Chitravati sands, everybody sitting around. Then Swami looked at this pious old lady and Swami asked her, Amma, do you want anything? What do you want? You tell me, I'll give you. And this lady promptly asked for something which none of us could have imagined. She said, Swami, my husband passed away. It would be very nice if I can have a photograph of my husband. So Swami said, Manchidi, has your husband ever been photographed? He said, no, Swami. He died before cameras ever came to this region. So when did he die? Swami, 20 years ago. So he died 20 years ago, which means Swami has never seen him. He was much before Swami's time. He's never been photographed. In fact, he has never lived in an era where he has seen a camera. He is no more, and this lady is asking for a photograph of her dead husband who has never been photographed. Swami very casually says, no problem. And typically, like Swami would do, Swami makes a mound of sand, puts his hand inside and pulls a crisp photograph of her handsome looking husband. You know, if Swami can do this, does He need to come with power? Does He need to come with money? Does He need to come and be born in an influential family?